Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. I am standing in between tea and your comfort. But the matter of fact is that I will take few minutes only. The Makli, you know, each one of us is more aware of Makli, and we doesn't require much of information. The only thing which is not really very correctly perceived is that the Makli has much of wealth of written word. It is the inscriptions of Makli which form the real treasure which catapults a visitor into the past. If we look into the richness of the material which is there, it has sacred texts. Many of the surahs from the Quran are quoted. There are the ahadith, there are the traditions, and there are also the funeral statements. The funerary structures are necessarily in commemoration of somebody who has been respected by the colleagues, missed by the successors, and also venerated by the society itself. So these monuments which are standing, these are the testimony of those emotional linkage with those people who are buried there. And the only link between us standing today in front of those monuments and the structure which is in front of us is the inscription which connects us to the past very correctly and very rightly. When we look into the material and substance which is within these inscriptions, it is an amazing wealth of Persian poetry. The poetry which was flourishing within our Western neighborhood, within the Persian world, which includes also Afghanistan. And on the other hand, we had a rich literary connections with Sultanate of Delhi, which subsequently reduced to the Mughal Empire and which doesn't have that much depth during those days. And we here in Makli are reflecting all these influences portrayed by the able poets here who were very much into the art of composing, and necessarily they were not very famous poet to make up to the capital in Delhi or Agra. Nevertheless, their poetic acumen is something which is required to be celebrated. But the first thing, do we know sufficiently enough about those poets? Do we know sufficiently well about the tradition of composition of elegies which were going on within this huge society? So this is the linkage. When we look into the inscriptions, we are basically going through an experience into the time machine. We are detached from those times. Here we stand within the modern world, having very new perceptions of the society. We don't realize that what society we are looking at. Theta itself, when we look at it, is not basically very good efforts. Thank you, sir. Now, once we have started talking about the inscriptions, I shouldn't be going back and giving you the background of Makli itself. We should rather continue where we were actually talking. There is certainly some problem with this. So don't worry about it. I'll take you to a journey which was a real tiresome journey for me. For 30 years I have been walking through all these alleys on the pathways of Makli here, and I have come through much of that particular treasure house which was referred by Kennedy as having 2 million graves on the Makli Hillock. And we have the citation by Annemarie Schimmel. She said that, well, over 1 million graves were still there on Makli. And when we look into the follow-up by all other scholars, they subscribe to the same idea, and they were of the opinion that there are millions of the graves on threat. Nobody realizes that in our oriental tradition, wherever you go, people will tell you, Sawalakh Olyavite Dafanayan. So this is the business of hundreds of thousands of the people referred as, but that should be a metaphorical reference. It shouldn't be considered as a technically sound scientific counting. Department of Archaeology and Museums, Government of Pakistan, in its heydays, when they were the custodians, they never made an effort to count the graves which were there on the Makli. And when we look into the citation of UNESCO, as referred by the gentleman here, they themselves were miscarried and taken away, and they were taken for a ride, and they, in their UNESCO citation for World Heritage, they have quoted, there are 500,000 tombs on Makli. So this is something which basically is the mainstay with us. This is the main force behind our appreciation and importance of the site. Nevertheless, I don't count the graves as an important aspect which will render some importance to the site itself, but the substance which is there, the material which is there, the quality which is there. Makli is the miracle of the written word. It is a museum of calligraphy. The calligraphic wealth which is available here with us, it is hanged, no problem. So just forget about the presentation. And then going through the sacred part of the inscriptions, which is the surahs from Holy Quran, we come to realize that there are at least 42 different surahs which have been quoted on the tombs on Makli. Out of 114 surahs, there are 42 surahs which are randomly and with a regular intervention has been there on these tomb structures. While looking at it carefully, observers can realize that this selection of surahs is not at all a random selection, but it is a conscious streak and some pressure and some presence of some sort of idea which is pursuing the person to select certain surah and put it there on the cenotaph. And this selection has rendered this whole sequence of things that whenever you are face to face with any grave there on Makli which doesn't have the date, which is undated, but the sequence of surahs, you can be certainly assured that within those 2 decades, this structure would have been made. So this is a, you know, a particular perceptive understanding of the surahs with the difference within the governing system and the social system of the Makli. The second thing is non-sacred text. That is the epitaph. That is the funerary statement. Within those funerary statements, you come across that there are such statements which have 46% of these have the dates. But 54% of the cenotaphs which are otherwise inscribed, they don't have the date. And out of those 46% which are dated, the date is hidden within the chronogram. Chronogram is basically the oriental art of counting the years through abjad system. As you all are aware that the tarikh goi has been all along a very preferred art form within this Orient. So the Persian world basically was the leading component where we have the tarikh goi practiced as an art form, and that was very much sorted after. When you look into the lots of public structures, the bridges, the mosques, the wells, you come to know that there are always qata'at-e-tarikh inscribed on those buildings. And these qata'at-e-tarikh, if you decipher, there is a year coming out of these. And this beautiful way of composing the real essence of the particular commission or the objectives behind the structure which is being made, and within that pura shayari you have the sense of the year coming in. So here at Makli we have more qata'at-e-tarikh than anywhere else. We have compared these qata'at-e-tarikh with the graveyard of Kabul. Kabul is a wonderful graveyard also, as we have here in Makli, they have also one. And this historical graveyard, if we are starting comparing these, we found that with the first qata'a, which is ascribed to one sahabi, and the subsequently the second qata'a is with the Babar stone. Babar's grave is situated in Bagh-e-Babar in Kabul, and it has the date of Babar's demise, and it is a qata'a-e-tarikh, and it is Manvi, Persian Manvi composition. Here, from earlier than Babar's qata'a, we have in Makli qata'at starting much earlier than that, and these continue. And in Kabul, the qata'as don't come up to the 18th century. There are only three qata'a before the 18th century. If we compare the both the societies, that means that the chatta of 16th and 17th century was more refined, literary, more elitist and versatile in composing those qata'as. So this distinction between Kabul and Chatta becomes very clear when we compare those qata'at-e-tarikh, those chronograms. And then we have another aspect. We have qata'at from Lahore. Lahore is another historic city, and they have a wonderful array of tomb buildings, mosques. But when we compare those qata'at-e-tarikh to which we take as a symbol of some literary elitist tradition, which must be considered associated with a society which is more refined, more trade-oriented, more rich and more cultured, and when we compare both the cities, we come to realize that Lahore has the lesser qata'at in 16th century and the earlier half of 17th century. The Makli is leading in that aspect. Another city with which we can compare Chatta is Ghazni. Ghazni has a very rich graveyard, and it is an amazing place to start finding the Subakdin's tomb building and its cenotaph. And continuing from Subakdin, we have this coming up to the last century. In this aspect, Ghazni is earlier than Chatta, but the time both the cities are coming to coincide with the age, then we find out that Chatta has left Ghazni much, much behind. I have received a wonderful visiting card Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention.
Okay, use later.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Lashari, for wonderful presentation on a very important topic, that is epigraphy. So now all the presentation, this session is over. So now tea is offered outside. So please.
I have come.